our respects to elders past, present and future and acknowledge any Aboriginal people who may be in the audience today. So thank you all so much for coming out on a Monday night. How's that echo? Is everyone hearing okay? It's a little bit echoey, so I'll try and speak clearly and slowly. We have brought you all here because, as you know, Melbourne is in a housing crisis. We saw just a little while ago an elder care study say that if you're on New Start, less than 1% of rental properties in the entire Melbourne region are affordable for you. Less than 1%. We have people for whom home ownership is just a fantasy now that will probably never become a reality. And people are now renting for life, but the power is still largely with landlords rather than with tenants. We have over 35,000 applicants on the public housing waiting list, and that is not getting better. It has not got better since the Labor government came to power 2 years ago. And last year we saw a 74% increase in people sleeping rough on the streets of inner Melbourne. So if you don't call this a housing crisis, I don't know what is. And one level of government doesn't have all the tools to fix the housing crisis. It needs a collaborative response. But in fact, all levels of government have some of the tools to fix this crisis. And too often, we see governments pass the buck to a different level of government or throw their hands up and say they have no tools at all. And the running order will be, we've got a couple of speakers and then a panel and lots of chance for you to ask questions. Our first speaker is Professor Michael Buxton, who's a Professor of Planning and Environment from RMIT. And he'll be talking to us about this theme of we can have it all. Because too often we're told that we have a choice. We can either have really low quality one bedroom apartments in huge sky rises in the city, or we can have unfettered growth on the outskirts of our city, taking up all our farmland. There's nothing in between. You have to have one or the other. And that's simply not true. And Michael's going to talk about how we can actually plan a city that includes affordable housing at its core. Then we'll hear from Adam Bandt, who will launch the Greens plan to fix housing across all levels of government. And then we'll have a panel moderated by Kathleen Maltzahn, who was the Greens candidate for Richmond and is a long-term community advocate, someone who's worked in the community sector for a long time. And she'll be facilitating a panel where we'll hear from experts, but also people at the coalface of the housing crisis. People who live in public housing, people who are advocating on behalf of tenants in private and public housing, and people who have been long community advocates for affordable housing in our city, and there'll be a lot of chance for you to ask questions on them. So, without further ado, I'd like to invite our first speaker, Michael Buxton from MIT.
Thank you, Alan. Welcome, everybody. If you want everything you usually regard as greedy, that I think to want everything in this context is just to be regarded as sensible, because we probably can plan a city that does cater to a wide range of needs. The trouble is that we're not doing it, and we don't look like it. So when we're looking at affordable housing, and discussing it, it's terribly important that we don't continue this siloed approach to urban planning and this concentration on various sectoral approaches, so that transport advocates advocate what they want as important above all other needs. Planning for high density becomes so important that it dominates the agenda. And once we take a segmented approach to urban planning in this way, then we lose out in the general amenity and benefits to the broad range of citizens. And this is the trouble that we have in Melbourne today. We're at a very important period in our history. We're moving from 4 million to 8 million people, we're told, to 2050. We're probably going to have about 6 million people living in this city by 2030. About 1.25 million people have been added to our population since the year 2000. So we're in the middle of a huge boom in population, and we're seeing incredibly important implications of this that are being ignored. The government is putting together a planning strategy, which is probably going to be released in about 2 weeks. And you can bet it's not really going to say much, if anything, about affordable housing. Its contribution to affordable housing is next to nothing, but the government made a big issue out of this. When you look at what it says, it will encourage a very small proportion of affordable housing in high-rise, fisherman's bend, apartment construction. Now, we know how to achieve inclusionary zoning. It's commonly applied by mandating certain proportion, 20, 15% or whatever, the figure is decided, a certain proportion of the housing constructed for defined affordable housing outcomes to provide diverse and affordable housing types. This government isn't doing it, the previous government isn't doing it. We know how to do it, but it isn't being done. So I think it's terribly important that we look at, first of all, the stage that Melbourne has reached. It is really, it is at a crisis point, not just in the low cost and high need affordable housing sector, but in the breadth of the housing needs for its citizens at a crisis point.
So effectively, for a young person, on an average income. Housing has become twice as expensive, right? And that's happening across the board, but it's hitting young people in particular harder because what can we do about it? Well, there's a number of things we need to do. And they're set out, I'm not going to go through every point that's on the plan here, but let me give you a flavour of some of the key things. The first thing is at a federal level, we're one of the few countries that sets up its tax laws to encourage people who've already got a house to own a second, third, or fourth one and to subsidise that, but to not give the equivalent amount of money to people who want to buy their first house. Right? And it's called negative gearing and capital gains tax deductions. And just for those of you who are not aware of how it works, in a nutshell, you can go and buy a house and rent it out and claim however much you lose as a tax deduction, right? And some of the other associated costs as a tax deduction. Now, that in and of itself isn't necessarily a reason to go and put lots of money in it, but then when you add the second bit, the capital gains tax discount, it becomes an investment strategy. The way the capital gains tax discount works is this. If you work, you will pay tax, it's called income tax, you don't have a choice about it, you've got to pay it. But if you're a wealthy person who makes their money from owning property or shares, and you make that gain through what's called capital gain rather than using it through earning income, you actually get to have a deduction of 50%, you pay 50% less tax on that for no other reason than you earned it through shares or investment properties or whatever. Right? And so when you put those two pieces together, what it means is there's this nifty little investment strategy, and there's plenty of people out there who will spruik it to you, that says come and buy a house, rent it out at a loss, claim that as a tax dodge, and then when in 5 years' time you want to move out, you can sell it, and you only pay half the tax on it compared with how you earn that money through going to work every day like everyone else. So you put all of that together, and it costs the budget about $12 billion a year. Right? We're spending $12 billion a year to subsidise a tax strategy for people who've already got a home to go and buy their second, third or fourth one, and it pushes up the cost of housing and it prices people out of the market. And if you're like me, I went to about six auctions before I bought my house, and at every auction that I went to, there was a buyer's advocate there who turned up and just kept bidding and putting the price up and up and up for some people that you could tell were never going to live in the house. They were just doing it there as an investment strategy. We need to get rid of those laws. We need to get rid of those laws so that we're setting it up so that our laws about housing are about promoting real shelter, not a tax shelter. Right? It's a very serious proposition when it comes to the construction industry. Because actually, if we have the kind of plan that we're talking about, it will be a boom for the construction industry in this state. And my view is, what better way of addressing rising unemployment and homelessness and also questions about what kind of economy we are going to have in the 21st century with the rise of China and then by taking that $12 billion a year that's currently just known as a tax break to those who don't need it, and putting it into creating a domestic sustainable building industry. Right? We are going to create tens of thousands of jobs when we start building the houses that we need to address that 33,000 people on the wait list. And one of the things that I would like to see is a big chunk of that going into prefab construction here in Melbourne. And I'll finish on this, but over in Brooklyn, there's a guy who's got this great little setup where they're basically building houses on conveyor belts. There's sort of shipping container size, but they basically come around on a conveyor belt and they add to them bit by bit. Putting in a substantial investment into building a stack of those, and we would like to see around about half of the new affordable housing stock being prefabricated here in Australia, is going to not only save a lot of money, not only save a lot of pollution by building them at the best conceivable standards, but it's going to create a lot of jobs right here in Australia as well. So I think it can tick all the boxes. And if we have a plan and have a bit of guts, we can actually elevate this to be the top level political issue that it deserves to be. And make sure Australia is a place where everyone is able to have a roof over their head, And we can say that's thanks to a government that actually stood up for people rather than just stood up for big business. Thanks very much.
Folks, good afternoon. My name is Rhys Crimmin. Like a legend of Bourke Street. He comes and dances all the time. Except I haven't seen him for months. Where you been? I haven't seen you for so long. There's one of the best air guitar on Bourke Street I've ever seen. I'm just playing the guitar. I think he wants the guitar for Christmas. Thank you. Thanks very much. I'm going to play a little bit of a didgeridoo solo for you folks now out there. This here is my special travelling didgeridoo. I take with me all around the world because I do have some traditional wooden types. They're too heavy and large for travelling, so I use this one because it's very light and compact, just made of plastic. It's also fun to play on its own because just by changing the length of it, it changes the key, so I can do little melodies and things with it. So I'm going to do a bit of that for you now. I hope you like it. Oops, I forgot to put some percussion on. So. Everything I do on the street here is done live. There's no backing tracks or anything like that. I just use my left foot here for a little bit of bass drum, and my left and my right foot for a little bit of tambourine, and then and play a little jam for you. Because I'm the best there's ever been. Strings and it made an evil hiss, and a band of demons joined in, and it sounded something like this. Alright, we're gonna have a little egg shaker solo here. A solo, and he just went for the vocal straight up. The devil finished. Johnny said, "Pretty good old son, sit down in that chair and let me show you how it's done." He bent behind the mower and moron. It was in the house of the rising sun.
Thanks, Ellen. Wanted to have an opportunity tonight to have a bit of discussion, to open up the floor in a minute for questions, but also in a sense to in anticipation of what Michael was saying about having a broad discussion about planning. We're not going to go beyond housing, but to think about within housing some of the different perspectives and the different needs. And so this panel is an opportunity to bring people together with a range of perspectives, to see the commonalities, some different perspectives. So we have four people here today. I'll start by introducing them, kick off with one question to all four of them, and then have one more specific question to them, or two, and then we'll open it up for questions of all the people on the panel. So, at the end of the table, we have Matoc, Achol. He's a community worker who works with young people particularly, around the Fitzroy public housing estate. He works with the African Community Foundation, and I've got an A on the end of that that I've forgotten. And he was recently one of the candidates for the Greens in Yarra's local government elections. Please welcome him. Next to him is Howard Marosi, who's representing tonight Friends of a long-term advocate of public housing, and Friends of Public Housing is one of the small who have been talking about the importance of public housing as part of our solutions around housing, and is campaigning particularly at the moment against the transfer of public housing stock to the private sector. Welcome, Howard. Yaelle Caspi is here from the Tenants Union of Victoria, the body that represents Victoria's renters, and as a policy officer, she's going to talk about some of the policy responses for private renters.
Maybe it would be easier for me to stand up so that my voice would be at least in every corner if possible. I thank you all for coming tonight or this evening. It's important that we come together and talk about things that are important to us. Yeah, I think the issue with housing, the huge issue right now, it's to maintain those sort of houses that are there already, plus at the same time catering for other people who have need for housing. For example, some families have more than two kids. They might have five, six, and they have two bedroom. That is a challenge for them because these kids want to have their own rooms, at least maybe two of them in one room. And I think that is a huge problem.
Sure. Well, I'm here representing Friends of Public Housing and also a new campaign which is Defend and Extend Public Housing. Over the last 30 years, we've gone from a position of building public housing, actually adding to public housing stock, to actually, under the Labor government, the Bourke Labor government, a policy of actually transferring, moving towards transfer of public housing to private organisations. Those private organisations do not provide the same standard of housing as public housing does. Just briefly, if I may, the situation with public housing tenants is that they pay 25% of their income in rent. They have security of tenure, and also anyone with a certain income is actually allowed to enter public housing. And that's not the same with what's called, well, we've heard a lot of talk tonight about affordable housing. Affordable housing is actually a term which is actually used to describe the private organisations which actually want to take over public housing from the government. They actually submit to the government. And secondly, to build more public housing. We're advocates for building public housing, not for building affordable or social or community housing, because of the superiority of the conditions attached to that form of housing.
Yeah, I might just say that I think tonight when we've been talking about affordable housing, substantially what we're talking about is when private businesses are building housing, but they have to have some that sells at a price that's affordable, so not instead of public housing, but it's an important distinction that you're making, so thank you. Yeah, what do you see as the biggest failure? I'm sorry to start with failure, it seems to be much in the week that we've got Trump as leader of the free world, but we wanted to go to the guts of what's happening, and then we'll go to some solutions.
Okay, thanks Kathleen, and thanks everyone for having me here tonight. I'm going to be talking about the private rental market, and I'll start by just talking about the changes that have happened in the private rental market over the last two decades. So private rental used to be seen as more of a transitional phase that people moved through quite quickly as they saved for a deposit to own a house or moved into public housing. But as those two avenues have become frequently less available to people, we see people living in the private rental market for a lot longer periods of time. So there's more people renting, long-term renters, more families renting, more retirees renting. In fact, the largest growing group in the private rental market are people people aged over 55. And with this decline in public housing and accessibility of home ownership, we've seen the government sort of defaulting to the private rental market as a place for low and medium income people to live. However, the experiences of people in the private rental market aren't necessarily that great all of the time, and that's because tenancy law hasn't really kept up with this change.
Sandell from the Greens, and really appreciate you having a chat.
Yeah, no worries.
Yeah, it's great. Affordable housing is a really serious issue, and many of the people that are in private rental are paying a lot.
Yeah.
Yep. What I can tell you is that my rental, because I'm in a shared house with three housemates, and our landlord's really good, and we have a good house and everything, and I think that's a really good model. But a lot of people in boarding houses and things like that are having a lot of issues. And
that's right.
Yeah, it's
and really also, what I've seen is that a lot of people are just totally priced out of the private market, but you've managed to be in it, and that's great. A lot of people have a good experience. But there's a couple of things. Firstly, a lot of people are completely priced out about it, and Anna Bett talked today about if you're a student, pretty much your entire youth allowance goes on housing, and that's not what it used to be. It used to be maybe you pay half the getting harder and harder. But secondly, tenants often don't have their own rights as well. So
it's really
hard to get repairs often, and you can be kicked out just because the landlord wants to put the rent up, like the landlord who doesn't want to do that.
Well,
you can't have repairs or something. A whole lot of issues, and if people are not able to afford to buy a house or go into public housing because there isn't enough, then you see more and more people living their whole life in private rental.
And also I think one of the other issues that wasn't necessarily talked about tonight, but I think it's another component, is the actual housing prices for people are buying houses. I mean, that market is saturated and the prices are through the roof.
And yep. It's because of our tax incentives. It's not that we have a lack of land to build houses. There's actually a lot of, say, industrial land, even in the inner city, places like Egay, which is a rail yard, essentially. There are places to build houses. It's not like we don't have the land. We don't have to expand the urban growth boundary. But we're encouraging, through our tax system, people to buy their second, third, fourth, fifth house, not their first house. It just doesn't seem to make much sense, because what's a house for is the question. Is it
just
a safe
for investment
place to live, or is it an investment? Well, primarily, it should be a safe place to live.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's what everyone needs.
Yeah. And the other thing that I've been covering over the last couple of weeks especially has been the stuff out of Bendigo Street.
Yeah.
And these houses were left, they were just left alone. They were seized under the East-West program, which was scrapped by the Andrews government. And many of those houses have just been left. And I know some of the guys and girls that are in there, and they've been looking after the houses. Obviously, they've had the police knocking on the door and issuing eviction notices and things like that. But and I was with one of them last week when he went to the Supreme Court and just walked out, and basically it was just about, you know, the rights of the government over, you know, kick those people out and they can sit on the properties.
That's
which
right.
Is, which is
and I said, as soon as East West was cancelled, I came out publicly and said all these properties that the government has now bought should go into public housing. Yep. The government's already got them.
Yeah, exactly.
So why are they just trying to flog them off to the private market? All the ones in Parkville they just put up for private rent, which seems like such a waste that they could actually have used them to reduce the public housing waiting list. And the thing that I've been really disappointed about is that Martin Foley, the Labor Minister, has really demonised the people who are trying to speak up and say, we're speaking because we're homeless, or we want public housing. He's really demonised them, and I just thought that was really unproductive. He could have engaged in the discussion. These people are raising some legitimate points.
Well, he's meant to be the housing minister.
But he's demonising them and just using really heavy-handed tactics where actually they're raising really
And the biggest thing that I note, and the thing that I think is really important, is that, you know, when I met Adam Bandt, for instance, I was actually homeless at the time, but it was really great to be able to have a chat with Adam, and of course when I met you, and it's been awesome to be able to meet these people that are in the upper echelons, necessarily in government and what have you, you know, everyone who's homeless, if you get them into affordable housing and they can, you know, stabilise housing, they can achieve amazing things. And I use my example as that because now I'm doing some crazy stuff.
You're such a good example of that. And housing underpins everything. Yep. If you don't have a safe place to live, no wonder you can't get a job, no wonder you can't get your health in order. And actually that just, you shouldn't think of it just in a cost perspective, but that puts incredible pressure on the emergency departments and the welfare system. Actually, if you just give people a house, which they've shown in many places, even in places like Utah, they eliminated homelessness. They just gave people houses. It allows people to get back on their feet and do all the things that they want to do, have some dignity, have some security, get a job, get a health in order, get a family in order.
But it all starts with housing.
Absolutely. Well,
thanks very much for having a chat. I know you're on a tight schedule.
Thanks for coming.
No worries, thank you. Cheers. Thanks, Adeline.